Small businesses have always faced enormous challenges in emerging economies in securing timely financing. Formal SMEs contribute up to 40% of GDP, a number that increases significantly when informal SMEs are included. In emerging markets, SMEs generate 7 out of 10 formal jobs. Before COVID-19, less than 15% of SMEs in emerging economies had access to the resources they needed to grow and create wealth. During the pandemic, access to financing from traditional banks has dried up even more, which has contributed to slowing down of economic growth. The MSME credit gap in India alone has been estimated at rupees 16 lakh crore, equivalent to $215 billion. The next panel on this subject is moderated by Abhiram Katta, Director, India Partners. And joining Abhiram in the studio are Kirti Kumar Jain, Founder and Chief Executive Officer, Anytime Loan, and Shweta Aprameya, Chief Executive Officer, Earth. And joining us through our virtual platform, we have Manish Bhatia, President, Technology, Analytics and Capabilities, Lending Card, Pallavi Srivastava, Founder and Director, ProcCap, and Sabyasachi Goswami, Chief Business Officer, Perfios. Great to have you all with us in this power-packed panel. And with that, I would like to pass the mic to our session moderator, Abhiram, who will take the discussions forward. Over to you, Abhiram.
Thanks, Amit. Thanks, everyone, for joining this session. Great to be part of this panel. We have a very distinguished and experienced set of people who have been in the fintech area, different aspects of fintech, and working very closely with MSMEs in India for the last few years. In fact, I think most of them have been there for more than 5 years in this sector. So I think it's going to be a really enriching session, discussing with them, learning from them on what's working, what's not working, and if really fintechs and MSMEs are a match made in heaven. So before we go into that discussion, let's discuss a few high-level points about this sector, right? So MSMEs are there, almost 60, 70 million, depending on different reports. In India, they contribute over 30% of the GDP, over 40% of the exports. There are over 100 million people who are employed directly, indirectly through these MSMEs. So that way, it's a significant chunk of our Indian economy. But on the other side, we see that MSMEs are struggling to get access to finance, either to do their day-to-day operations or for their growth aspects. So that's one big reason why I think this topic is very pertinent in today's times. We see that almost, I think, 15% of the debt requirement of these MSMEs is through formal channels, and the balance is through informal channels. Even today, with so much of technology, so much of financial institutions, infrastructure being in place. So we already have lots of banks, both public sector banks, private banks, cooperative banks, small finance banks. We have NBFCs, we have chit funds. And then there are the ongoing informal channels of money lenders borrowing from family, friends. And still, MSMEs have a big struggle in getting timely finance, in getting the requisite quantum of finance to run their business. So I think it's in that context where the fintechs have started taking off in this sector. A quick check on a very popular database related to startups shows almost 600 plus fintech startups in the Indian lending ecosystem. So now, it's not that all of them are focused on MSME. There are some who are focused on MSME, some who are focused on personal loans. And there are also fintechs which are focusing on the infrastructure layer of it, right? We also have a lot of fintech startups who are actually working on new ways of providing finance to these MSMEs, right? We have revenue-based financing, we have factoring, discounting, then we have platforms like Threads. So there are different ways in which people are trying to address this gap and provide the requisite finance for the MSMEs. So in that context, I think let's speak to our panelists here and understand how their ventures are trying to address this gap. What is it that's working? What is it that's not working in this setup? And what are the upcoming changes and developments that are actually going to change and make a sweeping improvement in the gap that we are currently facing here. Shweta, if you could start off. How have you seen this MSME side of the story evolving? from the time fintech started targeting that area to today, how have MSMEs started approaching these fintechs? How have fintechs started approaching this sector, and how has this actually evolved over time?
So, thanks, Abhiram. Businesses who are really very, very micro business owners, which means that they will be unstructured. They will not have those typical cash flows. They are not the taxpayers that we are looking for. They will not have the P&Ls to show to us. So how will they get access to finance? And I think that's the fundamental questions. They have other challenges like vulnerability to external shocks. And of course, more importantly, cultural constraints. In terms of if you look at the various challenges, the traditional models have not been able to cater to this segment. And that's where the fintechs really come into play in different shapes and size, where they are trying to look at alternate ways, and the data is not the only thing, but alternate ways in which various problems like these, when it comes to being unstructured, being vulnerable, having cultural constraints, not having the relevant bureau record, etc., to be able to give them timely, flexible access to finance. And I think the role of the fintech, if you ask me, is not just the technology piece, but also in terms of looking at how do you redesign your process, how do you reimagine the same customer, and how do you unlock this huge potential? And you just shared some really voluminous numbers that we are talking about. So from the way I look at it, I think since 2011, 13, 15, we have seen a few cycles of fintechs that have come in specifically on the digital lending side. And I think it has been very interesting to see that there have been various models that have evolved. And I think the need is to have the multiplicity of the models to address this huge market, because there isn't one size fit all. That's one of the most important messages for all of us. The second important point, Abhiram, here is within this large segment, there is a sub-segment which is women micro-businesses. And I think somewhere this aspect is where Earth focuses on quite a lot, to say that what happens to a subset which is human first micro enterprises, which is also in the tune of 15 to 20 million odd businesses which are run by women. They have even more bigger constraints outside of the vulnerabilities that we talk about, the structured lack of structured data points that we talk about. And how do you really address that larger segment? Now we're going through a flood situation in our country. As fintechs, we have to, and perhaps a lot of us are already thinking through it, what do we do to ensure that while we think about technology as a solution or as an enabler to accelerate the access to finance process, how do we also insulate our customers from these external shocks? And what is the process for that? Where is that innovative capital coming from to be able to protect our customers, to ensure that we continue the empathetic finance from a longer standpoint? Because we have seen what happened last year, and we are now seeing a flood situation, because micro MSMEs do get impacted with all these variabilities. Where is the empathy in the capital that the mainstream institutions are providing to fintechs? Because that is the raw material for our business. So I think the fintechs and all of us collectively as a community are trying to solve for three big things over the last decade, I would think. One, as I said, is looking at the problem from a customer standpoint. Second is looking at different cuts of the same segment, like Earth is looking at the women first micro enterprises. And the third is looking at the real vulnerabilities, which are not to be solved by technology, but really to be solved by bringing other ecosystem players, regulator, bankers, investors, into the conversation to say that how do we ensure we solve this big problem for micro MSMEs. So that'll be my perspective, Abhiram.
Sure. Thanks, Shweta. If we have Manish back, Manish would like to understand your views on how you've been targeting the SME segment, and how things have evolved over the past years, and what are the tech elements in the fintech play that you're doing right now?
Yeah, thank you. Overall, you know, I think again, you know, various of these events that have occurred, COVID, you know, demand, you know, floods, you know, these events have actually obviously have impacted the overall ecosystem. But at least from a technology perspective and how we are looking at the segment is, you know, one is, you know, how do we make sure that our distribution is not just a person who actually has a smartphone. So one of the tech plays that we also sort of trying to do is, you know, how do we make sure that we have a distribution channel that, you know, the last mile DSAs are able to take our offers to MSMEs so that, you know, someone else is sort of helping them through the process. I think the other is this discoverability, right? So how do the MSMEs know that, you know, there are opportunities, there are products that actually can help them? You know, one is, you know, for tech savvy MSMEs, it's about, you know, how do we reach them? But it's also a lot of MSMEs are not so tech savvy. So in that case, you know, are there local reach outs that you could do, you know, banners, making sure that, you know, we have some satellite offices that could actually go and speak to them. That's the other piece. The third piece is actually the product fitment. So, you know, if the distribution has happened and the discovery has happened, right, where, you know, the MSME has actually found, you know, any of the fintechs, I think the problem to really solve is, are we able to provide them the product that they really need? Or, you know, is it that, you know, they are basically being, you know, hand-twisted to sort of take some products because that's the only options they have. So how do we provide them access to more selection of loans, for example, a selection of products that they could actually use to actually grow their business? And I think the last and the most important is, a rate that something that they could actually take, which is the IRR. You know, how do we make sure that, you know, with fintech sitting in the middle, either NBFCs or whatever, right, the actual cost of borrowing actually somehow gets transferred to MSMEs because, you know, there are a couple of middle people in the middle, right, from the source to actually getting it there. Now, what are the innovative ways to sort of bridge that gap and directly take some of the middle people out, where, you know, fintechs can actually play a better role from an accessibility of the right product at the right IRR? So I think these are four or five things that we definitely wanted to focus on.
Thanks, Manish. Pallavi, I understand you focus a lot on the retailers, right, within this wider MSME segment. So wanted to understand how you're fine-tuning the reach out, fine-tuning the product offerings to gather more business from this segment, and how are you actually solving the retailer-specific problems as such?
I just want to paint a picture of the Indian retail economy, which all of us know it's close to $900 billion. 90% of it is still unorganized offline retail. And the challenge that is in front of us is how do we really include these last mile retailers into the formal financial ecosystem. And in order to do that, I think one of the ways that we found when we entered this market is that while there is a huge challenge and a huge, you know, there's also a huge opportunity in front of us, what we've been trying to do, you know, traditionally and, you know, including the fintechs and NBFCs that are trying to address this problem, we are looking at it from the lens of existing products many times, right? So we look at this customer, and I'm referring to what Manish said partly, that we need to understand the real pain point and the needs of these customers. It's not only limited to credit, but it's credit in a form that makes sense for them, right? So it's not really that we reach out to these customers with existing banking products and we will see that kind of an adoption. We need to tweak the product, need to understand the real challenges. And this retail segment, access to finance problem can only be solved segment by segment. So we cannot have a one-size-fits-all approach. And that's what we've been trying to do. We're trying to customize and, you know, we're trying to understand the supply chain, and we are trying to create products that make sense for these customers. And I think there's a huge gap still, cumulatively put together, all lending SMEs have not even catered to 10% of these SMEs in terms of including them in the formal financial ecosystem. So there is a lot to be done. And I think the only approach that will really work is really understanding and solving it by creating innovative products and being flexible to listen to these customers and adapt in terms of what we are really offering to them.
Great. Thanks, Pallavi. KK Jain,
yeah.
As part of the P2P lending ecosystem, how do you look at this problem? I understand your offerings range from a few days to a couple of years kind of tenure, right? So how much of your P2P lending happens for these enterprises, whether it happens on the enterprise name or taken on personal names and then used for these business purposes? And what kind of innovations are you testing out and trying out in this space?
Sure. Thanks, Abhiram. So as you rightly said, we are the India's on-demand peer-to-peer lending platform, right? So traditionally, if you look out, when we say on-demand, which means that we give a lot of flexibility to our borrowers to take loans at their convenience and the denomination and the tenure they are looking for. So there is no rigidity involved over there. So that's what we call as product adaptability. So if I'm a micro enterprise and if I'm looking for a 1 day or a 2 day loan, or perhaps a 3 years loan, that's the flexibility which you can get from Anytime Loan is concerned. Now, we have been speaking about the opportunity, right? Everyone speaks about the opportunity of MSME financing, but typically, I believe the core problem or the genesis lies over the education and the aspirations of our micro and small medium enterprises, right? And that has to be given a lot of impetus upon. A lot of MSMEs today in India, if you look out, they hardly lack any kind of aspirations. When it comes to aspirations, I mean to grow themselves, to grow their business from one locality to one city to one state, and perhaps one state to one entire country, and then cross the borders. Now, unless this movement comes from the bottom up, whatever number we are speaking about, $215 billion, that's a number. We really don't know on the grassroots level whether there is someone is there to catch that number or not. So while match can be made in heaven, the catch has to happen on the ground. And that's what we have to understand as all fintech players. Fundamentally. Now, when it comes to Anytime Loan, what we do is that very differently in terms of is that when we evaluate a borrower, we evaluate them in a particular different way of which we call as an alternate data science today, wherein we use a lot of predictive models as well, right? Like Shweta was also telling, we believe in responsible lending rather than just giving any kind of stereotype loan product to anyone, right? Second, we don't check your bureau score while you are applying for a loan. So that's open up the entire gamut of customers for them to experience the innovation of product that we have at our end, right? The third difference what we do is that we don't look at your bank statement alone to evaluate you. For instance, a person can apply for a loan in Anytime Loan, and people might agree, people might disagree, but that's what is innovation all about, right? We have a predictive algorithm which we use neural science, wherein we convert a facial feature and predict the intention of a person to repay back a loan, right? Now, these are something innovative fintech solutions which we have to come forward and try to understand and evaluate the borrower in a differential manner, not just looking at the traditional bank statements, bureau score, past repayment track record. Perhaps your social media interface or interactions also could give some kind of reflection, what we call as a day owl or a night preacher, right? Whether what time you are more active into a social media at a particular point of time. So all these data points can probably drive into a much more holistic way of evaluating a particular micro and small medium enterprise that could probably help you to take up the opportunity.
Thanks, KK Jain. That actually brings me rightly to the next question to Sabyasachi. So while we talk about all the fintech players out in the market who are reaching out to the potential borrowers and providing them credit, there has been a strong backbone which has been built in the country, right? There have been lots of players who have been building, whether you start with the recent account aggregator kind of setups, you talk about people who are helping EKYC, helping in risk management, AML measures. So there are quite a few startups who are, and even incumbents who are actually building this strong backbone for Indian financial services sector. So how have you seen these growing, and what are the things that are going to happen in the future, right? So right now, NBFC, AA and OCEN frameworks are still in a very infant stage right now. So how do you see that building up in the Indian context? And would like to understand your perspective in terms of would these actually reduce the gap between incumbents and fintech, given that all these techniques and technologies are being made available even to the incumbents, large banks and NBFCs. How do you see that playing out, Sabyasachi?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Abhiram, for this opportunity for throwing some light on the subject. See, to start with, first, as humans, we are always resistant to change. right? And I think Manish alluded to the fact that demon, COVID, or flood for that matter, brings you little more adaptive and closer to the technological change or adoption to technology. Okay. Not that the fintechs or startups, or you call it forward-looking banks or NBFCs, have not been trying to bring out this change and trying to help SMEs. I would not say whether all the SM and emerging part of SMEs have been able to take advantage of it, but people have been trying in different pockets. And what I have seen in all these three events, though there is a lot of negative to it, but the positive side of it is technology has been able to take a leapfrog jump in all these three events. I mean, flood has been on and off every year, but typically demon and the pandemic has definitely pushed the technology / digital agenda from an SME and the fintech perspective. Now, let me get to the next point, which you said that whether it helps bridge the gap. It definitely does, but we are not at a stage where we can say we have addressed the complete micro, complete small. The solutions has been so far more, it started with the medium and large enterprises. It is in last, I would say, about 18 to 24 months, it is slowly tending towards more micro and S part, because obviously they are more kind of impacted, affected. And we are trying to solve those problems, because that's where I think the large adoption will come from. Now, what are the things that we typically feel that the market will get increasingly excited about? It will typically be the convergence of currently the disparate components of the small business experience. It is increasingly going to be the, while all of us think about the credit, that is one element, but SME runs about, I mean, SME needs typical few other components which has to come together, which is, I think, there has to be invoicing, reconciliation, cash management, financial accounting into banking and vice versa. And I think there will be more innovative companies and platforms that will come to support the small micro businesses with the range of financing and accounting needs, and API-based systems that will make it easier to connect with the new components into a single comprehensive solution. And what I see is this banking services has to directly plug into the SME value chain. And there, that will bring about the next level SME fintech cooperation. Of course, I think Mr. Jain also alluded to the fact that predictive financing, so it will be, my feeling is, it is automation around predictive financing and a combination of accounting collateral management instead of traditional static lending that will do the turnaround and the job. That will primarily bridge the gap. I would say this is what we should focus on. And as a company, Perfios, we are pretty much focusing on those direction. How do we bridge this gap by applying all of this that I stated?
Great. Thanks, Abhisachi, on that. So I was just thinking that we talk so much about the big opportunity, the number of enterprises, how big a gap there is to actually bridge that. Wanted to understand from the panel, this is open to anyone who wants to share their experiences. Any areas where you thought this is something that is not worth trying in this sector? While 200 plus billion requirement, millions of enterprises, etc., is there, but there could be some things which just don't work in the Indian MSME sectors. So have you, from your past experiences, seen anything which doesn't work today, at least? And what changes might be required to actually ensure some of those solutions actually start working in the Indian context? So, if you want to share any of the past experiments that you guys have done, where there was a high potential which was seen initially, but then things just didn't work out. So, some of the things which as a layman, if we think, right? So there are lots of cash transactions which happen in the smaller enterprises just by the nature of those businesses. How do you ensure you are able to actually factor in that entire cash transaction happening to give them the due credit? Or if you go by, say, for example, just the POS-based lending, which is picking up, so you are getting a portion of their revenues. So are there any solutions that were tried out to assess and give them due credit for the transactions which are not getting tracked in the bank accounts or in the POS machines or through the UPI transactions, etc.?
Sorry, Abhiram, is that question to
me? It's open to everyone, Sabyasachi. I just wanted to understand the thoughts, learnings that any of you want to share. Pallavi, sorry, Shweta, you were saying something.
Okay, Am I audible? So, I hope I understood the question correctly, Abhiram, and if I've not, just take this as a perhaps an example. So I will sort of narrow this down simply to one of the, let me not use the word experiment, but research work that we've been doing about a year and a half. So because we work in the mini and the micro enterprise segment, most of them in fact are sole proprietors and sort of home-based businesses. And within that, since we focus a lot more on gender financing and gender sensitive part of the access to finance, the most important thing really is to understand how do they plan for financing, right? Before you start designing what's the type of credit that you're talking about. And in women, it was very, very interesting for us to see, and we did first a 3 months project really talking to about 200 women in those categories to ask them, how do you really save and how do you really sort of conserve your cash? How do you really take your husband's help to do the end of day tally at your store, at your shop? And where do you record it? So those are those typical questions, but without going into too much detail, we did this study in 3 parts. And every time we got different results coming from 2 different states. So we did a study in Rajasthan and then we did a study in UP. And across these 3 different stages, we got different output to say that we were not able to understand how do women think about financial planning, because they're extremely good planners at home. But when it comes to business, they are extremely protective about information. So the deficit is really coming from the fact that what is it that they want to share, which is the sort of the sole thing that they want to protect. And how much of that information they're willing to tell you, which is in the form of their finances. And different women were giving us different pieces of data points. And that gave us a lot of confusing output. That are we really talking about creating a physical diary of sort? Because these were actually home diaries that we created for these women. So are we talking about something which is actually has physicality to it so that it becomes more personal? Or are we going into the same direction of creating another app where, you know, she's recording in her own personal time what she does? Or of course, the third dimension is that bundle something with the credit so that you start sort of in a more quieter manner, start acquiring information about her. And all three sort of approaches, you could say, were important. But were we able to really conclude to say that which direction we should take? We were not able to take that. But it's a very small example to a very big problem that we want to solve, because it is directly linked to how we want to give value or create value for that woman who is going to be a long-term customer for us, which is starting with helping her to actually plan her finances as far as a business is concerned, not home, which is a very different aspect. And that was a very important insight for us. And we're still working on it. And we currently do credit plus insurance plus welfare services. But the financial planning tool side of things is something which is work in progress.
Great. Thanks, Shweta, for sharing that. In fact, that leads me to the next question. So Manish, if you could share any specific initiatives that are being done to get the MSMEs to adopt this tech way of borrowing and tracking their own business. And next, I would also want to understand from Pallavi how this is being done on the retailer side. But one way we are talking of is how the fintechs are reaching out to the MSMEs. So here I'm trying to understand how are MSMEs actually adapting to this new environment? What are the activities which are being done to make them more comfortable in this new digital environment?
So again, I don't think so there's one thing that LendingKart or any other fintech or bank could do. It's actually a big ecosystem shock generally, like COVID was one of those, right? If you really think about various different e-commerce players, Amazon, the Flipkarts, things like that, it is the way, I'll just sort of step back a little bit, right? So if I dial back to 1995, there was huge internet boom overall, right? Where in the US, you know, we saw a bunch of new e-commerce companies, eBay's, Amazon's actually come up. And the thing that they built their entire business on was the infrastructure that was already built, that was payments, right? Your ability to pay anyone, anytime, from home or from the POS, was something that was built in those countries, right? Developed countries. I think we have a very interesting challenges where we are trying to get adoption while we are building the infrastructure. And maybe payments, maybe people actually understanding how to use things. How people come to digital is by the Facebooks, understanding how to actually use YouTubes. And that is where they get sort of comfortable using digital. Now, you know, stepping from using social media to actually transacting is a completely different thing. That's where, you know, the payment companies have to come in play. Then it is about, you know, from transacting, how do I actually do my books digitally? But I'm actually a very firm believer saying, you know, these things have to be done. Otherwise, you know, all the access to all the good stuff that they're doing, they would not be able to take advantage of, because you could run, you know, all the programs, everything is obviously something, but to get mass adoption overall, I think this step of digitization overall for MSMEs is super, super important. We are doing a lot of these things in smaller areas, you know, for our customers, but I think it's the ecosystem overall, maybe the e-commerce players, the fintech players, the social media, it has to be a consolidated effort to make sure that MSMEs actually step up to it.
Right, and I was hearing some research saying WhatsApp has played a big role in people becoming comfortable with mobile phones. People across age groups, right? So earlier we had senior citizens not so comfortable, but after WhatsApp and chatting on family groups, I think people have started becoming more comfortable. So like you said, I think the whole ecosystem has to come together to build various aspects of it. So lending is just one piece of it. Even their transactions, social life, everything is getting digitalized. Perfect.
Bookkeeping and everything.
Perfect. So Pallavi, if you could share some thoughts on how are you managing this aspect in the retailers, right? Like you mentioned, there are quite a few who are very small in operations, may not have a computer, laptop kind of equipment to run their business, inventory, et cetera, right? So how are you managing to bridge this digital gap in that segment?
So two things, Abhiram. I think, you know, if I just take a step back on explaining how this retailer segment is really operating, and, you know, like Manish, absolutely right in saying that, you know, that this segment needs a lot more than just credit, right? There is a massive need for formalization and digitization of the day-to-day transactions. A lot of things are still happening on paper. You know, our model, you know, the way we work is slightly different, because we don't really go bottom up from the retailer. We go top down. So we work with brands, and, you know, through that we kind of, you know, underwrite the customers and find the data, etc. So it's a different structure. But coming to the retailer specifically, you know, what we found, you know, when we started back in 2018, I think one thing that really helped us was the GST, right? So earlier we saw that GST was not getting filed properly. People did not have the GST number. Within a year, you know, the adoption at the rate of adoption of GST that we have seen is phenomenal. And now I think there is a better understanding of the implications of not filing the GST in time.
Okay, Jain, wanted to get your thoughts on, so when you are targeting this segment, how much of these lending opportunities are actually new ones, which were earlier going to informal channels versus they diverting from the earlier formal channels. So for example, someone taking from a bank or an NBFC earlier, are they moving here, or people who are borrowing from the neighborhood moneylender or some other informal sources, they are moving to this formal sources? What has been your experience? And first of all, would like to understand where the mix is, and then maybe the reasons why you see if formal is still moving to these things.
Sure. Yeah, thanks Abhiram for asking that question. So as you understand, P2P lending is basically a digital banking, right? On one side, you have depositors or lenders or investors who are basically looking forward to this particular asset class as an alternative way to create and amass more wealth for themselves. And on the other side, you have borrowers who are basically not having an access to the formal credit or formal financing institutions out there, right? So the typical challenge of P2P in India is what? We have billions on one side who have trillions of dollars of requirement, and we have millions on one side who are sitting with trillions of rupees. That's the challenge we are trying to bridge into. The beauty of the product is that we don't have a liability to repay back, unlike a bank who has got an obligation to repay back to the depositors. Now, by virtue of this particular business model, right, what happens is that the cost of capital or borrowing from a borrower perspective is slightly higher than the formal sector, but it is far lower than the informal sector, for sure, right? Because when I am lending or depositing and giving loan to someone, I expect returns better than a fixed deposit, probably lesser than an equity market. That's what my aspiration is as a depositor. So I would be looking forward to lend at somewhere close to 18-22% per annum kind of stuff, and I expect that kind of an IRR. So what we have experienced is that the borrowers who come to our system right now are two sets of borrowers. One, those kind of borrowers who have been always been engaged with informal lending kind of stuff, pawnbrokers, money lenders, or neighborhood people who have been lending at 5%, 10% monthly rate of interest. So those borrowers come to a platform called Anytime Loan for that matter, and they are looking for a loan. The second set of people who have got good bureau score, right? Because traditionally that's a mindset that if I have got a good bureau score, I'm more financially better. That's a myth, I would personally call it. But people who normally can get access to from the bank are also coming to a platform called Anytime Loan for a simple reason. We have got the agility to give you a loan of 2,500 rupees to 5,000 rupees. A bank will traditionally not give you a loan of less than 60K or 100K, right? So that's the flexibility which we give it to. So rather than going and asking my friends and family members, I can come to such kind of application where I can draw down 2,000 or 10,000 rupees for a day or two. So even though I have an access to the formal credit, I would love to leverage such kind of ecosystem because it gives me a lot of agility, right? So these are the two sets of customers who are basically coming to a platform called ours.
Perfect. So Sabir Sachi, I would want to actually go ahead on that point. So between the formal and, between the erstwhile incumbents like the traditional banks and NBFCs versus the new age fintech players, where do you see more action in terms of getting onto these platforms which are forming the backbone and in terms of finding innovative solutions? Is it banks versus fintechs, or is it a banks plus fintechs? What is the market today?
Okay. If I step back 2-3 years back, it is bank versus fintech. If I talk of now, it is bank plus fintech. Obviously, everybody has realized that we can't go and fight our own battle alone. So it is better partnering, working together, and trying to solve the core moat problem, which is good for the overall ecosystem and the economy and for SMEs by themselves. But there is a lot of work to happen. As I think everybody said, whether it is Shweta, Manish, Alavi, everybody was saying, a lot of data is still physical, unstructured. When we say that, I mean, obviously, bookkeeping doesn't mean the bookkeeping happens in an ERP platform. The bookkeeping happens in a notebook as well. Now, when it is notebook, you can't truly digitize, right? So it requires then human intervention, and fintech cannot operate at that scale with a lot of physical intervention. So for fintechs to operate at scale, first, the data has to be available digitally. Now, whichever forms of data, it is not just a cash flow or a bookkeeping or any kind of financial transaction data. Any kind of data has to be available in a digital form, which brings down your cost and hence to better have an efficiency. Ideally, it's cost of acquisition, and we pass on that benefit to the SMEs. So there is a lot of work on that has to happen, and which is not just lying or sitting with the fintech or the bank. There is a lot of push that is required by different authorities, whether it is authorities at a government ministerial level or by the regulator. I see both of the agencies taking a lot of steps. In last 6-8 months, we have seen a lot of steps taken both by the DFS and the regulator in moving certain things, including the KYC, which will help SMEs also now. But that is just, I think, the beginning. There has to be lots. So if that happens, then I think the partnership between the large banks or forward-looking banks and fintechs will play a huge role in bridging the gap what the SMEs require today from a formal credit standpoint. Otherwise, this informal credit will continue. The pawn brokers will exist, and SMEs will pay those high IRR unless we make more and more data available, digital data available, for taking quicker, faster, real-time decisions at real fast speed. Because what today, or the legacy problem, is that I need the capital now, I will only get that for credit available to me after 30 days. I mean, by that time, the need is gone or it has got diluted. For that to happen, you can't operate physically at scale. So there is problem in hand, both sides. The data not being available. If data is available physically, I can't solve. So it has to be the complete ecosystem which has to move. And Manish touched it beautifully that while internationally, there are payment systems which is available, and on that, the other applications or platforms have kind of rode upon and made the journey. Whereas in India, we are trying to do those both the things parallel. So it's not going to be easy. But yes, I mean, I think we have taken this step on the right direction, which is we have moved on that.
Right. And I think, Shweta, your organization is actually working on the tech plus in-person kind of a network, right? So can you explain how you are solving this area, which tech alone could not do it, and what elements are being handled by tech, what elements are requiring in-person presence, because of which you are setting up your offline network?
So, and I think one common theme that I'm hearing all of us were talking about, one thing is clearly flexibility. And perhaps the second part to this is the unstructured data. And I think we're all solving for that. At Earth, we actually run both models. We run working with brands to provide the necessary financing. But a bigger part of the work really is where we're actually doing data collection for different segments which are run by women. And I know this is a long road. This is a more challenging road. This is not the fast feet road. But the way we look at it is that if we start collecting and curating the data, and we just don't do it for business, we collect economic data, social data, health data of those women that we are trying to target through the universe mapping in the areas that we work in, we would be able to better assess for the customer that we are targeting, but at the same time be able to collect and aggregate that data, which will allow us to build a better model in the future. So we are taking a view to say that we are here for the long run, as there is a lot of digitization which the ecosystem is anyways enabling, whether it is the e-commerce companies doing it through their channel. And I think in many remote parts of UP, I'm already seeing that. I do now start hearing a Swiggy and Zomato as well, which is great. And these things do really help. And you spoke about WhatsApp, but there are the big giants which will go deeper, which will sort of fasten the process. There's government which is sort of enabling that. There's the private companies which are enabling that. But as a player ourselves, trying to solve for micro enterprises, we feel that it's our responsibility, and most importantly, from a long-term perspective, to be able to collect and curate this quality of data that will feed into our system, which allows us to do better credit, give better credit decisions right now, but at the same time create a database which can create better lookalikes to better predictive analysis, which is focused on the segment that we cater to, which is women, and the occupations that they work. So this is the approach we are taking in Earth. As I said, it's not a quick approach. This is a patient approach. And that's the way that we want to run this model. While we, of course, continue, you know, doing the credit products, of course, the what we call in our system, by the way, is end-day loans. We do very similar things. There's no tenure, and we keep that flexibility with our customers. But the data structuring part is to be solved by the ecosystem and by companies like ourselves through better mechanisms of data collection. And the last point to this, Abhiram, is our model around data collection is not just us doing it directly, but through hyper-local partnerships. So that's one thing that we are trying to crack this year. Of course, last year got washed out in COVID, and it was very hard to reach out to hyper-local partners. And NGOs are great facilitators, if you ask me, and I think we sort of have to build that infrastructure because they're very close to the customers. And then there are the Vyapar Kendra, and there are many hyper-local partners. If you go away from the big brands and the big companies or the tier two kind of companies, you can actually create a great platform with hyper-local partners who could be great agents for data collection. And I think that's the work Earth is doing to ensure that we sort of, one, do this from a sort of a patient roadmap standpoint, but at the same time, work with the hyper-local partners to accelerate some of that process.
Sure. Thanks, Shweta. I'm also conscious of time. So before we take a break for some questions, I would want to just do a round across with the panelists and get your quick thoughts on two things. One, if you can identify one big change that has impacted this part of the business, the MSME financing business, and one big change that you want, your wish list. And it could come from any corner, right? It could come from the MSME side, it could come from the government side, it could be for the regulators. If you were to change one thing, improve one thing, to make a sea change in the way today MSME financing is happening in India, I want to understand your thoughts on that. So we'll start with you, Manish. One big change that has happened till now, which has actually moved us to a different orbit, and one more change you want to move to the next orbit.
Yeah, I think both are quite connected. So if you're asking me, am I satisfied with the change that I'm seeing on the ground? I don't think so. And I'll actually not directly answer your question, sorry about that. But if I look at what I would like, right, it is where we shouldn't think about banks and fintech, shouldn't think about the addressable market as a zero-sum game, right? It is a positive-sum game where, you know, for US and the China, they have a 21 and 15 billion trillion dollar economy, and for India, it's about 2.2, right? So the address, the market that we're looking at is at least 100 times less than what it should be, considering our potential and population. So I think it's all about digitization, and it's all about being able to provide access to credit, which is how the other countries actually grew, if you will, right? Because what you do is actually look at the future and give the MSME some loans in the present so that they could do what they want to do. So I think the change I would like to see is how we can overall work as an ecosystem to provide that digitization to our MSMEs and not be so worried about, you know, overall, you know, internal competition, because I don't think so that's even a worry right now.
Thanks, Manish. Pallavi?
From my side, Abhiram, if I'm audible now, I had some challenge with the internet. I hope,
yes,
am I clearly audible?
Yeah.
Great. So I think from my side, it's more, you know, my wish list includes, you know, more relaxed norms around, you know, fintechs. I feel that, you know, at PropCap, we add a huge value to, you know, the retail economy, financing the retailers in the last mile. and you know that itself and a lot of other fintechs who are doing this, right, trying to really include the excluded customer segment. I think it's time now, and there is already some bit of the work happening there, but I think it's some time before we can actually say that we see the kind of scale that a lot of fintechs in Europe have seen. For example, you referred to, you know, some of the challenges and models that have not been able to pick up that kind of scale in India. You know, I think just looking at the liability side of the product, you know, I think the fintechs have not been able to win that kind of trust with customers, which large, perceivably more stable financial institutions have. And I think, you know, if we get that kind of a push and support from RBI, you know, that the customers will be more comfortable transacting with fintechs. It's happening on the payment side. It's slowly happening on the lending side. You know, I think we'll slowly see if that change happening in the liability side, and we'll see more startups like, you know, Monzo and Klarna, like in Europe, emerging from India as well. So that's my wish list. I think one big change and impact on us has been GST, which has really significantly propelled the way we are running the business, and that's been very, very helpful.
Thanks, Pallavi. Sabyasachi, your thoughts?
So two or three things. I think what has been helpful is at least the different institutions, and when I say different institution, as I said, whether it is different industry bodies, the authorities at the department ministerial level, or the regulator, all have at least realized the potential opportunity and have started to look at it favorably. Though the progress has been slow, but I think there is some movement that has finally started happening. So that's a good thing, though not as expected. The wish list is from all quarters, which is different institutions have to be open to first share data, which itself is a challenge. Though openly nobody would want to admit that itself is a challenge, right? So when you want to give a formal credit, you need to first have an access to data. And data rests with multiple, at multiple level, with multiple, at multiple segments and with multiple institutions. So that needs to be kind of unwind, and it needs to be made available. And next is where you are looking from fintech perspective, you don't have a lot of your own funds, right? I mean, you are dependent on external source of funds. So the horizon need to be a little long and broad. Otherwise, what happens typically under the pressure, you are trying to squeeze, narrow down, and are truly not serving the SMEs. So we may all call it that we are trying to serve the SMEs, but I don't know we are serving either our investors, board, stakeholders, whosoever it is, but not SMEs. So we need to truly, I mean, expand that horizon and keep a little long window to kind of deliver the output what the fintechs would truly want to deliver.
Thanks, Sabyasachi. Shweta, your wish list.
Okay, so first, I think the big impact that we saw at least last year, I would actually give the credit to our customers. COVID was a washout, and I think the entire lending fraternity was worried and concerned. But when we started looking at the portfolio, we were very surprised. And I would celebrate our customers, especially the micro enterprises who run this economy to a large extent. They showed the resilience, and trust me, that gave us a lot more confidence to say that, you know, the customers that we are targeting are genuine borrowers, and customers that we are targeting need that support, and they could be the biggest change makers themselves. Right. So I think this is the biggest impact for us as a company, and a big learning that we are on the right track with the right set of customers. The wish list really is, I'll keep it short because I think everybody has sort of checked up most of the important points, but really is in terms of the patient capital. And I think somewhere we have to be very clear, and we have to speak this quite out loud. We work in a segment where patient capital is needed, and I think some sort of the softer side of the large pool of funds which are available have to come in to also give scope for innovation. And I think the private sector, the PE ecosystem, the VC ecosystem, the CSR bodies and the grant ecosystem can really facilitate this kind of innovation, which brings a certain level of risk as well as a long-term view for us to really unlock this huge opportunity. So that will be my wish list, I think, adding Thanks. On to everything else.
Yeah. KK Jain.
Yeah. If you permit, I have a long wish list.
No, we don't have the time. No, so if you can keep it.
I'm just kidding, right? So the first thing is that from a P2P side, of peer-to-peer lending point of it, we have been requesting the regulator that if I'm a depositor or a lender, whatever losses I incur, that should be allowed to be set off against my income tax liability, right? So that's one thing which will encourage, because how much the formal institutions will come forward and lend to this micro/small enterprises, I have my own reservations, because they have to fulfill their own aspirations of internal stakeholders management, right? In the boardroom, what they have to do. So the RBI has to come out completely and say that, okay, we'll encourage retail depositors to participate in this emerging asset class, which further helps the entire bottom-up economy to access the formal credit. That's one thing. Second, I would say that the regulator should always have a differential regulation compliances. You can't have a similar compliances for a startup which is doing 100 crores of annual lending and a bank which is doing probably 100,000 crores of annual lending. So that's one thing which has to be taken care of. Last piece, Abhiram, the definition of NPA needs to be revisited in an emerging economy called as India. I might be radical here, right? But I would love to voice over here very clearly. We are basically going to give loans to MSMEs, which are by virtue of the nature, they are doing business. And business by virtue has got inherent risk, right? And if you qualify them as NPAs, eventually if they default, what I mean to say is that if I am giving a loan to X person, and if the X person has utilized that fund for the purpose which the loan was meant, and let format the money goes into down the drain, it should not be qualified as an NPA. Unless the person is misusing for some other purpose, then it's an NPA. But if it's used for the same purpose, because end of the day, the money has gone into economy, either for creating jobs or for creating an expansion supply. That has to be a perspective for India for next at least 7 years. If we really want to come out of next, keep on saying the same statement, we are emerging economy for next 100 years.
Thanks. Thanks, Manish, Pallavi, Sabyasachi, KK Jain and Shweta. It's been a real privilege to discuss with you, learn from you, engage deeply on this topic.
Where there is life, there is hope, there is meaning. But life has its downs as much as its ups. Life is about challenges. Life is about opportunities. Time for joy, time for celebration, and time to introspect. Thankfully, in every one of life's moments, and even beyond life itself, there's LIC. Where there is life, there's always LIC. Zindagi ke saath bhi, zindagi ke baad bhi.